I'm going to talk about the rarest color in nature, okay? And there's a reason why I also chose this particular background today. And first, I would like to ask anyone, do you know that which color possibly could be the rarest color in the nature? And I'm talking about natural colors. I'm not talking about a pen or a t-shirt or a, you know, whatever, like a floor, maybe tile or whatever. Anyone wants to just take a shot?
Is it blue?
Who's this answering?
Shweta.
Shweta, I have a prize for you in the end of this presentation, okay?
Yay.
So I'm going to be talking about, and bang on, Shweta, it's a color blue. So you must be wondering now, how is this the rarest color in nature? Blue is everywhere, like, goddamn, look at the sky. And if you talk about the sky first, because let's get that thing out of the equation, and I'm sure all of us have studied about sky not being blue or whatever color back in school, maybe, or, you know, whenever we learn about this fact that sky is essentially not blue. Essentially, light comes from, the primary source of light is sun, right? And from sun rays, we can derive all the colors, whatever colors are there. Like, essentially, we call them seven colors. And if you use a prism and throw light on it, we get seven colors out of the thing, you know. So it's a ray of light which gives us all the colors. And there are hues and tints which essentially from where we can derive any possible color by combining them. So how it works is sun, you know, throws light. As soon as it enters the atmosphere, it becomes wavelengths. You know, sorry, the light comes in different wavelengths. And because light comes in different wavelengths, it interacts with nitrogen, oxygen, dust, carbon dioxide, God knows what particles are there in the air. Essentially, all wavelengths of light, you know, react differently. And that is the reason why some of them get absorbed, some of them get refracted or reflected or whatever. And essentially, it is three colors, which is violet, indigo, and blue, which because of their lengths in the waves, the wavelengths actually, sorry, they get spread the most. And that is the reason why we see these colors predominantly in the sky. And when it becomes darker and it becomes night, it becomes black. So for example, right now it's raining in Delhi, and whoever is there in Delhi can look at the sky. The sky is completely white. You know, even if there are no clouds, you'll see a different color, sometimes completely blue, sometimes something else. So the thing is, sky is not blue, okay? Now, since the biggest thing in the nature, which is essentially always thought as blue, is out, I would like to come to the smaller things, okay? Let's talk about the blue whale, right? This is a blue whale. It's not blue. And that's a peacock, right? You can see so many shades of blue on it. Everyone would be thinking, oh, this is a chal, this is blue. This should be blue, not blue. This is a blue jay. It's a beautiful bird, one of the most beautiful blue, you know, birds or whatever out there, not blue. Its name is Blue Jay, but still not blue. This is a person with blue eyes, not blue. So, and why, you must be thinking. Now to explain this and explain the reason why this particular color is available in the, it's actually the rarest one in the nature, I would like to take help of evolution, a little bit of chemistry, a little bit of physics, and a little bit of history to explain it. Okay, so I'm going to start with the butterfly, which comes in beautiful colors, yellow, and you look, a blue butterfly. You must be thinking, yeh toh blue hogi at least, but yet again, not blue. To explain this, I will go like at a macro level in the butterfly's wing, and I'll try to show you that what makes this butterfly look blue. And if you actually go deep in, like, you know, at a molecular level, you'll see, you know, certain structures on its wing. And those structures look like this, right? So what happens is that all light comes and interacts with this particular structure. And right now I'm talking about the blue butterfly, not any other butterfly. And they are very different at molecular level, each one of them, different colors, right? So this particular structure on a blue butterfly absorbs all the colors except the color blue. And blue gets reflected, and that is why we see the butterfly as blue. And you must be thinking, Achal, this applies to everything else. No, in nature, if you talk about a green leaf, it is green in color, right? It's oh yes, it's reflecting green color, but it's actually its base color is also green. But only in terms of the blue color, there is none. Actually, there is only one butterfly only, which has a certain patch of blue on it. Otherwise, there is no bird, no fish, no plants, no flowers, nothing which is available in blue. So moving on, I'd like to show you a video. And please mind that no butterflies were hurt during this video. And this is actually a video of a wing of a butterfly. It's a dead butterfly. And this video will show you how light reacts to the wing of the blue butterfly. And when a little bit of alcohol is poured on the wing, how the color of her wing, the butterfly's wing, will completely change. So I'm gonna just play this one. So this is a wing and, wrong clip. Yeah, so this is a wing. And as soon as light is put on this wing, we see the blue color shining, and at different spaces was showing differently. As soon as they put alcohol on the wing, that certain portion turned green. So basically the base color of this wing was actually green. This was not a blue butterfly, this was a green butterfly. And as soon as this alcohol just vaporized, the color was back. The blue butterfly is again looking blue. So this applies to all the birds essentially. And the reason why even in the rainy time, we see these butterflies to remain blue, or a bird to remain blue, is because at the molecular level, again, their wings are waterproof, and the only color they are reflecting is blue, and they're absorbing everything else. So no matter how wet it is, if they're in the Amazon rainforest or wherever, they will be able to reflect the color blue whenever they want, like essentially, which they will if they are built that way at the molecular level. So why this happens, right? So essentially, if you've seen Nat Geo or Discovery or anything else, I'm right now talking about birds. I'm not really sure about other animals or species, but birds do try to impress their, and try to mate by showing off their wings, colors, and the beautiful feathers or designs, the shapes which they have, and their dance forms, etc. So about 3,000 years ago, there were birds. They were trying to look around the nature, and they used to see things different colors, and they used to try to react or evolve according to those colors available in the nature. So blue was certainly a rare color, and since these birds are no chemists, they could not experiment, or because they'll just end up making a mess out of it. So it actually took 3,000 years for these species to slowly change, evolve at a molecular level to be able to show off this blue color. And this all happened with evolution, with millions of species coming and going, millions of generations of animals and birds coming and going. Today, we can see, if you go back after this call, you Google, you like blue animals, you'd see 10 rarest blue animals. And in that list, you will find a blue jay, you'll find a blue frog, you'll find an iguana, probably one butterfly, like I said, and that's it. That's about it. 5-6 different species. And yet again, they are not blue, except that blue butterfly. And now I'd like to talk about a little bit of history in terms of, how humans, we have seen this color, and how for us, especially our generation, this color has completely been normalized. Now, like I said, blue was completely rare in the nature, and our ancestors used to see almost the same colors as we did, but interestingly enough, they never showed this blue color in any of their artifacts, clothes, drawings, paintings. It's not that they did not know how to make blue color. Egyptians found out how to make blue color. I'll come to that. And in this painting also, if you see, this is an old painting, I don't know from which era, but they're actually showing the rainbow to only have three colors. And they also at that time believed that blue color is essentially not available in nature, because it was not there anywhere. And they never knew what to call this color. For them, it was only three colors. And even if you look at their maps, the water, they showed it to be green. They see there's a patch of blue in between, but essentially for the purposes of water, they used to show it green. Today, we look at any globe, any map, we see the color as blue. right? Like in my background, you can see the blue sky. We call it the blue ocean, but it's essentially not blue. It's just a reflection. And even in ancient languages like Hebrew, Hebrew, Greek, and Chinese, there was no word for the color blue. There was not at all, like zero. And with the evolution of time, more languages came in, and you know, and even then, the color blue was actually coming out of the word for color green, and it was more of an expression than a color's name. It was like, you know, for white they used to call it shining. Similarly, if I have to give an example for blue, that's what they called him. I can't like really pronounce all of these words, but yeah. So that's how the color blue was always perceived. And interestingly enough, in the 1800s, there was this person, William Gladstone, who actually deciphered or maybe basically presented a brief of this book of Homer, which is an ancient Greek philosophy book or poetic, this thing, which was written back in 1750 BC. And in his book, you know, the number of colors were mentioned many times. So as you can see, black was mentioned 200 times, and white 100, red was mentioned 15 only, and then yellow and green 10 times, and blue was not even mentioned, nowhere. And, you know, like I said, Egyptians did know how to make the blue color, and they used to call it, the name's gonna come here, yeah, Itiru, whatever it is. They used to call this color as Itiru, and they knew how to make it, but, you know, with the fall of Roman Empire, the formula of making this first synthetic blue color was also lost. And later in 13th century, a wort, it's actually a plant, was a yellow color plant, which was used to make the color blue. And this was the second time when actually human civilization figured out how to make color blue. And at that time, they used to call it blau. And when it was made, there was no name for this color. And was so expensive that it was hardly ever used in any of the paintings or any of the clothes. And like, you know, top leaders like Charlemagne or, you know, Napoleon, these like top leaders only had things which were blue in color. Could be a blue coat, could be, a blue staff or whatever. So moving on, I think after another couple of hundred years, there was this guy called Despoch, and he actually needs to be thanked for all the manga you see today, for all the buildings we are in, because it was his invention which actually made the color blue become a normalized color for our generation or a few generations before us as well. So what Despoch was trying to do was he was actually trying to make the color red a unique version of it, a more brighter or a different, you know, popular red he wanted to make. And how red color was being made at that time was with the help of this particular insect called cochineal. And I would like you to focus on the word cochineal, because if you cut it in half, the rest half is neel, and that is what we call in Hindi or Sanskrit the color blue as neel or neela, right? So actually cochineal was an insect which was used to create a red color. And when Despoch was actually experimenting to create another version of red, by accident he mixed some drops or maybe some animal blood in that particular experiment. And at that time, because in his experiment, actually, when animal blood got mixed, and since animal blood has iron in it, the whole chemistry stuff happened, which I can't explain really. And blue, true blue color was actually formed. And this was the first time a true blue color was, you know, made, and it was possible to use this color in the masses. And from that time, we've seen the Parisian army using blue color. We saw the blue color being used in, you know, Japanese paintings, and then, you know, in their architecture, clothes, and, you know, soon Japanese manga started using the blue color. And, you know, soon, you know, Sir William Herschel also came into the picture. He introduced blue prints. And that is the reason why I said, you know, if you have to thank someone for Dragon Ball Z and, you know, buildings, thank Despoch. And actually, when it came to experimenting with the red color, he blew it. I don't know if that joke landed. Okay, anyways, moving on. So soon, you know, this blue color, because it became available at a cheap price, people could easily make it. You know, a lot of armies, you know, went away from any other color and started using blue colors in their uniforms, navy, police, you know, even the blue collar labor came out because they started wearing those clothes which were dyed with blue color, which is denim, and blue became completely normalized as a thing. And that is when you know, Sir Isaac Newton came in the picture about 350 years ago, and when he was experimenting with the prism and he was trying to look at all the colors which were coming out, that is when he realized that this color needs to be given a certain name or an identity. And that is when he actually came out, and actually first there were five colors which he pointed out, but then because, you know, he wanted the colors to also be in synchronicity with the musical, sorry, I jumped the slide. Yeah, so when basically there were actually five colors which he first named, but then he wanted the five colors to be in synchronization with seven things, seven music notes, 7 days a week, and at that time there were seven planets only, including sun, the seven planets. And that is why, where he introduced two other versions of blue and two versions of blue and one version of orange, whatever. So basically seven colors came into the picture at that time. And since then, if you go out and ask anybody, blue has become, you know, one of the most loved colors for people, one of the most favorite, actually, you know, ask people, this is the research showing that, you know, how much people like their color. This is a, you know, pie chart showing whose favorite color is there, you know, the percentage wise. And, you know, overall color preferences have changed. Blue is a favorite color and all that stuff. So today, like, you know, if tomorrow somebody tells you, today or tomorrow, whenever somebody tells you, we live on a blue planet, our planet is also not blue. And as a quiz, I'll just quickly show this picture, and somebody should answer, like, which of this, there's only one thing in this entire picture which is naturally blue. Can anyone answer?
Is it the butterfly?
No.
Smurf.
No.
This the Smurf is, yeah.
Smurf is very close though.
It's naturally blue. It's been done like, yeah. Blue, so it is naturally blue.
You're very close.
The Navi people.
Yeah, technically speaking, yes. According to the story we have seen, yeah, they're blue. But the right answer to this would be the blueberry just under the Smurf. And even the blueberry, you know, if you go biologically in depth, whatever, they're supposed to be made of red phosphorus or something like that. But I'm not really sure about it, so I did not go into that part of it. But if next time you go on a nature trek or, you know, a walk or whatever, and you see anything in the jungle or the trek, just notice one thing. There is no blue except the sky, which is also not blue. It's all greens, reds, yellows, probably shades of whatever brown, but no blue. So I think that's my time. And Shweta, since you're, you know, you guessed the color blue, congratulations. What happened to my slide? You're it. You're next.
Wow, that is quite tricky.